Thank you, Anne. Good morning, everyone, and good morning to those of you who are watching via our YouTube. This morning, we have at the entrance to the chapel the word for today, which is for three months. I think it's 3 months. Please, you're welcome to take these. They're 5 minutes a day, minimum. You can do longer than that, but they are available up there if anyone would like to have them. Anybody here today for the first time?
Me.
Just because you've been travelling the world, all you've done is come home to rest.
I doesn't count.
No. Welcome back.
I don't know, I get a goodie bag.
No goodie bag for you. I think Michael, you're new today. We like to give people a little welcome, and John will have a little bag with a few little bits in it for you. So very welcome to you from all of us, and look forward perhaps to having morning tea. We're going to have a little video now. Most of you would know that Michael Galea's wish was to go home to Malta, and Margaret, one of their daughters and a granddaughter, were able to take back his ashes and do that just before Easter. So the family have just made this little short video. It does have music, but it's about taking Michael home. So enjoy it. I'm sure if you want to know anything more, Margaret will be happy to speak to you about some of the scenes that are in it.
I sit here thinking, as the sun is sinking, roar o'er the mountain and the dry, dusty ground. As the night is falling, I start recalling the nights in my own hometown. I see their faces in familiar places. I hear the music that we played away back then. My heart rejoices as I hear the voices calling me home again. Take me home to the people I left behind, home to the love I know I'll find. Oh, take me home. As the sky is burning, my mind is turning to the cold winter evenings by my own fireside. So far away now, but any day now, I'll sail on the morning tide. Oh, oh, take me home, home to the people I left behind, home to the love I know.
Come a time that our story would end. understand. But I guess I'll have to try. It's not easy to say goodbye.
Taken home he was. Oops. Knocked our tomb down, rolled the stone away even further.
Well, yes, good morning to you all and welcome to chapel today. The story of Jesus on the road to Emmaus guides us today. The journey is the path that leads us to understanding and to new life. In the midst of confusion and doubt, love walks beside us. So let us respond to that. Come walk with us. Let us walk together. Christ goes with us. Let's pray. Holy One, we're often confused by the events in our world, so come and walk with us. Open our hearts to hear your truth. Plant the seed of new life within us. In trust of your loving presence, we pray. Amen. Friends, God is our strength and refuge. Let's continue in prayer, friends. Let's pray. O Holy One, as we come together to remember your great sacrifice, thank you that we can experience deep in our hearts the incredible nature of your grace. Thank you that we unite with all the followers of Christ across the earth and all that have gone before us. As we contemplate the great price you paid for our sins, Come and draw us together to embrace and forgive one another as we confess our humanity, our fragility, and our need of your Spirit. Help us as we endeavour to be your hands and your feet to the poor and the oppressed. As we go from here today, may we carry your gospel of peace. May you fill us with your Spirit deep within our hearts. And as we lift our eyes to worship you, refill us with hope as we glimpse again the promise of heaven. Loving Lord Jesus, the one fully engaged in life, forgive us for our whatever attitude, our indifference. Forgive our nonchalance in the face of your call. Forgive the indifference we show in regards to the suffering and life needs of others. Forgive our apathy to join wholeheartedly in your work for justice and the common good. Forgive our hesitancy in giving more of ourselves in loving service to people who need it from us. Forgive our fear of really following you, which we mask with false confidence in doctrine and surface spirituality. Awaken real faith in us again. Startle us anew with the power of your love. Engage us once again in your work of love and grace. Call us back to the transformative power of loving service and faithful witness to you, that we might know that you are in our lives and the lives of all people, working for good, no matter whatever we do. Call us to do whatever we can to work with you, to do whatever is needed for the good of all, whatever the cost. We pray all this in his name. Amen. Friends, God's promises are for us. They weren't just for those people some 2,000 years ago and further. They are as much for us as they have been for all to come and all who have been. By the power of the Holy Spirit, God invites us, each one of us, into newness of life, forgiving each one of us and blessing each one of us, to which we can say, thanks be to God. John and Robin will be bringing us our readings today. Thank you.
The Old Testament reading is from Psalm 116. I love the Lord, for he heard my voice. He heard my cry for mercy. Because he turned his ear to me, I will call on him as long as I live. The cords of death entangled me. The anguish of the grave came over me. I was overcome by distress and sorrow. Then I called on the name of the Lord. Lord, save me. What shall I return to the Lord for all his goodness to me? I will lift up the cup of salvation and call on the name of the Lord. I will fulfill my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people. Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his faithful servants. Truly I am your servant, Lord. I serve you just as my mother did. You have freed me from my chains. I will sacrifice a thank offering to you and call on the name of the Lord. I will fulfill my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people. In the courts of the house of the Lord, in your midst, Jerusalem. Praise the Lord.
The New Testament reading is Luke 24, verses 13 to 35. On the road to Emmaus. Now that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. They were talking with each other about everything that had happened. As they talked and discussed these things with each other, Jesus himself came up and walked along with them, but they were kept from recognizing him. He asked them, "What are you discussing together as you walk along?" They stood still, their faces downcast. One of them, named Cleopas, asked him, "Are you the only one visiting Jerusalem who does not know the things that have happened there in these days?" "What things?" he asked. "About Jesus of Nazareth," they replied. "He was a prophet, powerful in word and deed before God and all the people. The chief priests and our rulers handed him over to be sentenced to death, and they crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one who was going to redeem Israel. And what is more, it is the third day since all of this took place. In addition, some of our women amazed us. They went to the tomb early this morning, but didn't find his body. They came and told us that they'd seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. Then some of our companions went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but they did not see Jesus." He said to them, "How foolish you are, and how slow to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Did not the Messiah have to suffer these things and then enter his glory?" And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in all the scriptures concerning himself. As they approached the village to which they were going, Jesus continued on as if he were going farther. But they urged him strongly, "Stay with us, for it is nearly evening, the day is almost over." So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and began to give it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he disappeared from their sight. They asked each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he talked with us on the road and opened the scriptures to us?" They got up and returned at once to Jerusalem. There they found the 11 and those with them assembled together and saying, "It's true, the Lord has risen and appeared to Simon." Then the two told what had happened on the way and how Jesus was recognized by them when he broke the bread. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Thank you.
Thank you.
Welcoming a new friends today, we also welcome back some people who have been away a while for different reasons. Welcome to you all, those who have been holidaying and doing other things. It's good to have you back. I should have said at the very beginning, Tony isn't with us today. I hope you're watching. I will ask questions later. Tony's got COVID. This is the second time. So Gina is also staying at home for a little while. You know, she works in aged care, so she needs to be very careful also. Jenny's not with us today. She has COVID. David Saunders is not with us today. He has COVID. And we have other people who just are not well. So in your private prayers during the week, please remember these people. Let's pray. Loving, living God, open our ears that we may hear your message. Teach us your truth and sow the seed of your eternal life-giving word within us, that we, each one of us, may grow in love. Amen. You know, there are a number of turning points in the gospel narrative, but perhaps none is as vivid as what happened to two despairing disciples who met the living Christ on that first Easter day. Let's imagine that it's evening on that first Easter. Walking northward, that way, along the narrow road to the village of Emmaus, are two of Jesus' followers. Their shoulders are slumped, their heads are bowed, and even a casual observer can read the dejection and the disillusionment on their faces. Utterly disheartened by the cruel death inflicted on the one they had thought was God's Messiah, these two men symbolize all the disillusionment and despair that hangs over our world as people ask, even today, why do bad things continue to happen to good people? For a long time, they keep walking in silence. Then the younger man bursts out. He says, "He's dead, Cleopas. Dead, just like any other man. They killed him. And we did nothing to stop them." Maybe the authorities were right. Maybe he was just an imposter. What fools we were, Cleopas, to have believed in him. Well, the older man's silent for a while. He's lost in deep thought. And then he responds, "Fools? Yes, I suppose we were, but who can blame us? He seemed like the Messiah. He certainly was all I ever believed the Messiah would be." Without raising his head, the young man responds. He says, "Cleopas, I too believed in him. I trusted him. I was ready to follow him anywhere. But he's dead. And what can a dead Messiah do now?" Well, the two walk on in silence, but they're so lost in their own despair, they don't even realize that a stranger has joined them. Sitting here now, you and I know that the stranger is Jesus, risen from the dead, but the Bible says very pointedly, they did not recognize him. It's not until later that evening, as they sat at the dinner table in Emmaus, that the stranger takes bread, he blesses it, and breaks it in the old familiar way. Suddenly, the
scales fall from their eyes. And these two despairing, doubting souls recognize the living Christ. The turning point in their lives comes only when Jesus is both risen and recognized. Now let's look more closely at the change that occurs in these despairing lives when they recognize Jesus. First, Jesus lets them see life in a whole new way. As they left Jerusalem, all they could think about was the treachery that twisted the evidence against an innocent man. The hypocrisy of the priest who professed to have murdered Jesus for the security of the nation, of course. And the ruthless unconcern of the soldiers as they nailed Jesus to the cross. For them, the darkness of evil seemed to shroud their entire world. Nor is it hard in our own time to see a world that bears a startling resemblance to the world those disciples saw that Easter evening. Ours is still a world filled with incredible cruelty, with injustice, with hatred, with greed. It's a world where for some, God seems totally absent. Ours is a bad news world. We make a big deal when we see on the TV news or read in the newspaper a good news story. Yes, ours is a bad news world, but that is precisely where the risen Christ meets us. In the midst of our despair, Christ comes, not like a superhero to right all the wrongs of the world, but rather as a strengthening presence who opens our eyes and lets us glimpse life from a different perspective. It is the living Christ who lets us see the possibilities in the midst of our problems and who reminds us, though the wrong seems off so strong, God is the ruler yet. Easter. Easter is God's reminder to the world that it is not the forces of evil, but rather the Lord God omnipotent, all-powerful, who reigns supreme. For those two despairing disciples, their whole way of looking at life changed. It changed when Jesus was risen and recognized. In his book, God's Time and Ours, A. Leonard Griffith tells the story of Ethel Mulvaney, a young woman working for the American Red Cross in Singapore in 1942. And I'm just trying to think, is that the Changi Chapel down there, one of those? We do have a picture of the Changi Chapel somewhere. It is one of those? Yeah. Along with more than 4,000 civilians, she was imprisoned in Changi Jail by the Japanese when they took control of Singapore. The jail, built to accommodate a maximum of 450 prisoners, remember, I just used the number 4,000. It was built to accommodate a maximum of 450 prisoners, would be her home for the next 2 years. She and the other political prisoners would suffer from the crowded conditions, the hunger, the flies, the filth, and most of all, the isolation. No news from the outside world ever reached them. As Easter Sunday approached that very first year, Ethel went to the prison commandant requesting permission for herself and a small group of Christian women to sing for 5 minutes on Easter morning in the courtyard of the prison. 12 times her request was denied. Miraculously, on the 13th request, I suppose we could read a lot into that, couldn't we? 12 times no, but the 13th, 12 disciples perhaps went, but it was only when he came. Something for another time. The 13th request, she and the other women were granted 5 minutes, 5 minutes only, to sing together. Well, early on Jesus' morning, they lifted up their voices singing. They lifted up their voice and they sang, Jesus Christ is risen today. In a very real sense, their only hope was the risen Christ. Their only hope in that dirty, dusty, filthy, fly-ridden place where they were isolated. Their only hope was the risen Christ. Then the guards came to march them back to their cells. But, and you know how much I love that word, but, the big pregnant pause. As Ethel Mulvaney reached her cell, her guard reached under his tunic and he pulled out a tiny orchid, placing it in Ethel's trembling hand. He whispered to her, Christ did rise. Christ did rise. In that very moment, Ethel knew for certain that the living Christ was there, right there with them in Changi Jail. For Christ was not only risen, but at that very time he was recognized. Risen and recognized. Put that in today's context of social isolation that so many suffer from. The second change that the risen Christ brought to those two despairing disciples on Easter Eve was a new joy. Christianity is by far the most joyous of all the great faiths in this world. That joy is based on the fact of Jesus' resurrection and the amazing promise that not even death can separate us from the love of God in Jesus Christ. Not even death can separate us from the love of God in Jesus Christ. In Christ, friends, we are given a glimpse of eternity. We dare to believe that not even our death is the end of our life story. We dare to believe that the same power that raised Jesus from the grave is available to us, to each one of us, and it's available right now in whatever we're facing. Jesus' resurrection means for us the power to begin living eternally and doing that right now. It means that the living Christ is saying to our hearts, to yours and to mine and to you people out there in YouTube land, he is saying to each one of us, my love can cleanse any sin. My power can help you face whatever it is you are facing. My victory, Jesus is saying to us, my victory over death can even take away your fear of dying. If you were here last week, you may recall I spoke of that very fear of dying. Has it ever occurred to you that if somehow we could talk to an unborn child while it was still in the mother's womb, we might discover that that little child feared the inevitable moment of birth, going from one environment, safe and sound and secure, into the unknown. It might be that as we speak with that child, it might be, as many of us fear, the inevitable moment of death, that transition from the here to the there. Yet we believe in life after birth. And we greet that new arrival with such joy, don't we? I mean, the latest one to have a grandchild or a great-grandchild here in the chapel, I think, is Tor and Tony. And her face, she's got her smile doesn't go to here, it goes all the way around and back again. Sorry? You've got a grand...
My great-grandchild
is... Oh, awesome. Yes. Is this why? You have the big smile on your face. We believe in life after birth, don't we? We do greet that new arrival with such joy. Could it be that this experience we call death is in reality nothing more than a kind of birth into a new and even richer life than any one of us could possibly imagine? The joy of Easter is that glimpse into eternity, which comes when Jesus is not only risen, but when he is recognized. There's one other change that the risen Christ brought to those two disciples in Emmaus on that Easter evening so long ago. When they recognized Jesus, the disciples suddenly had a new task of telling the good news that Christ is alive to all who would listen. Those two men were quite literally energized by their discovery. Could you imagine it? Suddenly, their tired feet, which had barely carried them to Emmaus, those tired feet were forgotten. They ran the 7 miles back to Jerusalem with the incredibly good news that we have seen the Lord. Their experience with the risen Christ gave them a task that would motivate them for the rest of their days. It is the living Christ who calls us now to bring good news to our bad news world. When Jesus is both risen and recognized, the world sees men and women with a whole new perspective on life. Men and women filled with an overwhelming joy, and men and women with a mission to tell the whole world in both word and deed that the Lord is risen, for he is risen indeed. Friends, as you go forward today, take the risen and recognized Lord Jesus Christ with you. Let people see him in everything that you do, everything you do in word, everything you do in deed. May they see in you and through you the risen and recognized Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. The servant king, during which time your freewill offering will be received.
Thank you.
Let's pray. God of love, source of all goodness, you hear our cries and you answer. It is with grateful hearts that today we bring our gifts to you. We bring our offerings as a gift of thanksgiving for your presence in our lives. We are your servants, and we offer not just this money, but we offer ourselves in service to you with joy. Amen.
John.
Let us pray. Loving God, our eternal Father, we come into your presence this morning with just 2 days to go before Anzac Day. Our hearts and minds are reminded of all those who paid the ultimate sacrifice so that we might live in peace and safety. And at the same time, we acknowledge the ultimate sacrifice paid by your Son, our Saviour, whose death on the cross atoned for the sins of all mankind. We pray for all those who put on a military uniform or a police officer's uniform, for by doing so they are proclaiming that they are prepared to put themselves in harm's way to ensure our safety and our well-being. Father, we heard in recent days the heartbreaking news of several aged care facilities closing down as they are unable to continue operating. Our hearts go out to and we pray for all those residents and their families who have been so adversely impacted by these closures. Please help them to find suitable accommodation to replace that which they have lost. And back here in the village, Father, we pray for all our residents who are going through difficult times with loneliness, debilitating health issues, or confusion and anxiety. Please encourage, comfort, and sustain them. And we bring before you now those of our fellowship who are suffering various ailments. We pray for Sally Marsh as she is recovering from a recent fall which broke her hip. Please surround her with your healing presence and return her to normal health as soon as possible. And also there is Jeannie Sellers, who has had a second fall this month. She is in Northern Beaches Hospital and also has contracted COVID. And also in hospital, we ask for prayers for Maureen Picknell. David, her husband, is recovering from skin cancer and needs your prayers as well. Also with COVID, there's David Saunders and we heard Tony Bradford. We also mention Wendy Gray, Margaret Wigley, John Bowers, Ben Taylor, John Seddon and others. So please, Father, give them peace of mind as they confront their health issues. We pray also for the staff and the management of the village that you would guide them in all their decision making, all their decisions that affect the well-being of all the residents. Please guide and strengthen the nursing staff as they cope with long hours and other manpower issues. We thank you for our chaplains, Tony and Bob, and we ask that you would continue to sustain and encourage them in the performance of their essential duties. And we thank you, loving God, as always, in the name of our Lord and Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you, John. One of the things that I did pick up on my emails this morning too is that Kokoda, just across the bowling greens, they have a couple of cases of COVID over there. So if you're going over there, you need to make a booking, and they've gone into full PPE mode over there. Going from not having to have a rat and just wearing a mask, which was very much appreciated by many people who were visiting, unfortunately, with these cases now, they've gone back to full protection.
Let's join together in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Yes, last Wednesday we had our march, our amble for our Anzac Wednesday service from PCH. It was wonderful that we had Sir Peter Cosgrove himself in attendance on the day. You may have seen some photos. You may have noticed that he wasn't the reviewing officer out here. Our dear friend Lynn Duffy was that. Sir Peter was pushing his mate, Colonel Mike McDermott, in a wheelchair from Peter Cosgrove around the march route. Michael McDermott used to live down in the Dardanelles. He now lives over in Kokoda. Hopefully he's not one of those with COVID. And he was the best man at Sir Peter and Lady Cosgrove's wedding. They have a very long association. And it was a wonderful service in its entirety, I think. Starting with the veterans' voices who regaled us very well all the way through. Sir Peter spoke of his experiences of Anzac Day, and I think those of us who were there would have come away with a wonderful feeling that our country has been in great hands with Sir Peter and in the different roles he's had, but also he gave us encouragement to go forward. Tuesday will be our service. I encourage you, if you can, to attend up at the top gate at entrance B. 6 o'clock, our service will commence up there. We have Admiral Lee Goddard, CSC RAN retired, will be our guest speaker up there. And there will be, I think, bacon and egg rolls or something like that afterwards with a tea or a coffee. But I encourage you, if you can, to come and share with us in the commemoration of Anzac. That leads us into me inviting David Picknell, the chair of the Residents Representative Council, representing all of us, to come and deliver us our prayer for Anzac Day. Thank you, David.
Good morning, everybody. A prayer for Anzac Day. Lord God, who desires peace for all people, on this day we pause to prayerfully, respectfully, and thankfully remember the contribution made by men and women during the wars and conflicts and while training for battle. We think of the many people killed in action, those who were wounded, those who suffered in body, mind, and spirit long after they returned home. We remember relatives and members of each community who made a sacrifice of their lives that we might live in peace and freedom. Help us to show our appreciation for their sacrifice in the way that we live. We pray that the qualities of courage, mateship, self-discipline, resourcefulness, loyalty, and good humour that was demonstrated by the Anzacs will continue to be an example and inspiration for us. We also remember the mates and family members who carried the burdens of loss and grief and carried on the work of raising families, producing food, and building this nation. May this solemn moment remind us of the privilege of life and of the depth of gratitude for those who died in battle. Lord, teach us to develop new ways of resolving conflict in our homes, schools, communities, and between nations. We pray for those who engage in the slow and patient work of diplomacy. We pray that you would bless all who live in Australia, those whose ancestors are custodians of this land, those born here, and those who choose to make it their home. May grace, mercy, and peace be with us today and always, through Jesus, Prince of Peace. Amen.
Friends, we have called on God, and God's word has spoken in our midst. Christ has joined us here and will stay with us, even as we depart from this time of worship. The Spirit, the Holy Spirit, is moving in our lives, revealing the truth of resurrection and life through all that we say and all that we do. So may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you as you walk the paths of life, knowing that Jesus himself is with you, blessing you with his presence. Amen. Lord of all hopefulness,